Good morning, afternoon, whatever you want to call this time. Thank you all for coming. Today we're going to talk a little bit about music curriculum and how I've been able to try and implement that in an urban school setting. I've been at J.B. Young for the past 10 weeks, so that's kind of my case study. But to start things off, I'm going to give you a little something to read. Keep it on the side that has the number on it. Looks like we're all about there. Who had number one? There's the number on it, Marnie, yeah. Have any thoughts to share? Any brief synopsis of what it was you were reading?
Well, this seems like a varied sort of experience. They rotate music instruction with gym and art, okay, which I think is pretty typical. Class is 30 minutes long. They do have opportunities to play instruments at an early age. Mm-hmm. Okay. Many of the activities incorporate dance, art, social studies, so there's some interdisciplinarity. By the fourth and fifth grade, they're learning to read music and integrating that with recorders, mm-hmm. Which is a segue into band, where it says 50% of the fifth graders join. I mean, first glance, I would say this is probably an effective use of time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Who had number two?
This one is 60 minutes long, and they also rotate with art and gym. They do play instrument, and they start to record at third grade, and they read music just during that time, but most of it's based on awareness and appreciation for the music. And then not many students end up going into band, orchestra, choir, although it is offered.
And then one of the things that I caught my eye was the very last sentence that says, as the curriculum rarely meets the needs of her students. So it's kind of throwing students into a fire that's not necessarily going to help them or guide them.
Yeah, in that situation, the curriculum they use is a very commonly used textbook series called Spotlight on Music. Mm-hmm. And it is, I think maybe 70% of schools I've ever been to use that. It's a very widely used curriculum. And for most of the time, they rarely follow the curriculum. It's what they own and has a lot of resources, but it doesn't exactly meet the needs of their students. And this school in particular, she struggles to make it work for her kids. She's constantly reinventing her curriculum and moving away from that model. But yeah, a lot of great appreciation things going on in that class, a lot of great listening and engagement. Who had number three? Yeah.
So this one is, classes are 35 minutes long, again, rotating with art, gym, library, technology. This actually talks about two of the teaching philosophies and things that we use. So ORC and Kodai are two of the big ones that music teachers use. So it's a lot of hands-on activities and up and moving around the classroom types of activities. And it said that most of the students end up going into band, orchestra, or choir, like an overwhelming majority. And then something that really stuck out to me was the curriculum is almost entirely of the instructor's own design, which is always the case.
Yeah, but
for us.
As far as I know, this instructor does not go to any textbook. It's all just out of her own binder.
Mm-hmm.
So another way to go about it. And then Abby, you had number four.
Yeah, this music program rotates every other day with gym, and each class is 40 minutes long, and it's geared towards a lifelong appreciation for music, with exposure to masterworks of music and popular music. Dancing and movement are also important parts of this class, as well as playing instruments. And the students are also exposed to a wide range of academic vocabulary. And they do have options for band, orchestra, and choir, but about 20% of students join. And this curriculum is also the instructor's own design, pulling from his interests and experiences.
All right. So. Yeah. Any thoughts hearing four different music curricula? They sound very much the same, kind of different, nuanced differences, big overarching differences. Anybody have any thoughts on what we've heard just now? First reactions, I'm not expecting any in-depth analysis of the curriculum yet. Yeah.
There's the kind of the route that a lot of people take, the spotlight on music versus creating the own curriculum,
mm-hmm.
versus which is what some music teachers do.
Yeah, definitely.
The participation in like the band, orchestra, and choir, I think, is a good indicator of how effective the program is, because it's making students really want to learn more, and so there's some staggering results in those programs.
Yeah, so providing them opportunities to continue their music.
It's a big logistical differences, you know,
yeah.
when the classes offer, length of time.
Yeah, so there's one class in here that has 60 minutes
mm-hmm.
every third day, whereas compared to, I think, which we're at 35 minutes every fifth day. I mean, just huge differences in terms of those resources.
Yeah.
So these four schools are all schools in the Quad City area. They're all schools in which I have spent at least 30 hours in my time here at Augustana. So in some ways you'd expect them to be more similar than not, because they all come from this, at least the same Midwestern music education approach, which is actually very different than Texas or West Coast or East Coast or anything like that. So they have some similar philosophy, they have some similar demographics, but you get quite a bit of different stuff going on. Just from what you read, flip your sheet over and you can see, this is a very informal way to gauge the curriculum, but you have four schools with extremely different curricula. I think there's one school that has a lot of blacked in dots and one that doesn't have many, but that doesn't necessarily say anything about the quality of the curriculum. It's just what's being focused on. Is there more breadth or depth in what they're doing? So this poses a lot of problems for music educators. We have a lot of things and ideas to cover, and we don't necessarily know the best way to balance that. What kinds of thoughts do you think you might have in terms of developing curriculum for music, and how that might be problematic compared to, say, math or English or any other subject?
Well, I think it actually is a really good comparison to math. There's a lot of things that you can and should be able to cover during a year, but you're kind of stretched over the course of a year, and you try to get more a wide range of topics versus the depth in one or two particular topics throughout a year. So I think the same issues arise, and it's kind of the decision of the instructor which route you want to go.
Yeah.
This may be naive on my part, but math I feel like is more like sequential, like you need to have this skill in order to get to the next skill and stuff, and building on each other. I feel like music has elements of that, but it's more like just different categories, so you can kind of go up different direction.
Yes.
It's not really like step by step.
And that's something that music teachers, I think the other two music teachers in the room agree, what is a big benefit and a big terror to us at the same time. We have to. We have a lot of opportunity and a lot of openness in what we design, but at the same time, we're very, you know, there's no right way to do it. And there's, I mean, not to say that in math there's only one right way to do it, but there's no clear sequence in how we're going to do it. I could teach rhythm for the first 3 years and not sing a single note, or I could do the exact opposite, and you could say that there's validity in what I'm doing either way. And that's what we're kind of seeing in these four case study schools. They're taking very different approaches to music education, all of which have a certain degree of success in those classrooms. I can say from my experience with these teachers and these students, they are gaining a great appreciation for music through a wide range of activities, but it's difficult for us to do that. So how do these teachers get this great curriculum put together for their students without any sort of strictness or strong policy? Well, here are a couple of issues. Also, we didn't mention, I jumped ahead of myself a little bit, but there are differences in resources, differences in the way programs are set up. You see, my school starts band in fourth grade, the one across the county starts in seventh grade. That's a real thing in Scott County in Iowa. North Scott program starts in seventh grade, whereas Davenport, I believe, starts in fourth grade. You obviously can't have the same music curriculum set up in that regard. Bowling Creek Elementary has ORF instruments for every student. They're very expensive, but very useful. They're great in getting students engaged and playing real, live-sounding instruments. Whereas the other elementary school has a class set of kazoos and a couple banjos. What are you going to do with that? You can't have the same curriculum for those students. They don't have the same resources. And then the students in the community in my school only don't listen to Mozart. They only listen to hip-hop and R&B. That's another school that I've worked in. That's actually where I student taught. They were like, I don't want to listen to Mozart. So my cooperating teacher used a unit on hip-hop to get them engaged, to get them thinking critically about music they were actually interested in. And then she kind of segued into more classical, common era stuff. So how do we cater to all these different needs and all these different resources that are available? Our standards for music education, which were adopted in 1994, they do that. And these are often celebrated by teachers. They have been for the past 20 years. We've really enjoyed these. I think the other two music teachers in the room would agree. They're great guidelines. They're free and they're loose. I think we all, they're easy enough that we can memorize them. I'm not looking right now, but number one is singing, number two is playing, number three is improvising melodies, four is composing, five is reading and notating, go on. Am I right? I'm good. But yeah, you get the idea. They're very easy, they're very memorable, and they cover the big ideas and what you want to do in music. I don't think I've ever looked at these standards and said, well, this is obviously missing, right? Those of you who have worked with them pretty extensively, they're really good resources and they're a great way for us to start framing our program. They're open, easy, great guidelines, and they're not nationally mandated. That's the other great thing we like about it. Maybe this type of activity is not going to work great for my students. There's no national commission on forcing you to use my national standards, making you do this. You can say, you know what, we're going to do a little less of national standard number 7, and it's going to be fine. As long as my students are gaining an appreciation for music, that's what these standards are concerned with. However, we're starting to come into some places where we have some issues. So I've had 9 lesson plans. One of them covered each of the standards. Are my kids good at music yet? It's kind of hard to say. You can't really assess based on my kid sang something alone and with others in a varied repertoire. Are they good at music? Are they appreciating music? It's kind of hard to say. Are we doing enough of any single national standard? Are we composing enough? The answer is usually no. That's the number one concern of elementary music teachers. Am I doing enough composition? But there's no guideline that kind of says, you know, this is how much you think you should be doing to get your students engaged with this. And then, of course, there's the world of Common Core and high-stakes testing that we live in, where these national standards don't really serve teachers all that well in terms of developing curriculum, where we're required to often tie our performance results to Danielson model and using Common Core kinds of things. And, you know, there's Common Core for English and for math, and that prescribes curriculum very easily for those kinds of teachers. But what about music? Why don't we have this nationally, not necessarily mandated, but very strongly structured program for us? So there's a solution that is coming out this June. Mm-hmm. The National Coalition for Common Art Standards has been, for the past several years, trying to develop new national standards for us. And they look like this. They're a lot more in-depth. And there's actually one more of these graphs. There's 11 standards, and then substandards, and then elementary standards, and band standards, and orchestra standards, and music technology standards, and music theory standards. And they're far more intensive than anything we've dealt with before. So I asked a couple of music teachers and some of my peers about, what do you think about the new standards? I'm like, oh, I haven't seen it yet. Can you list them for me? I'm like, no, because look at that. I mean, that's extremely intense.
Looks a lot like Common Core.
It's exactly like Common Core. Yeah. They designed it like that on purpose. I've read there's 1,100 pages of reports on how it's integrated with Common Core. Mm-hmm. And actually, it's kind of hard for you to see, even with this blown up version of just a third of one of these standards, it's hard for you to see. But every one of these standards has Common Core types of words integrated in academic vocabulary. Mm-hmm. Select, explain, and demonstrate. Select or choose music based on preference and evidence, things like that that will integrate it more clearly with English and Math Common Core. And so on that level, it's useful because we can kind of touch on Common Core a little bit. It gives teachers a little less pressure when we're asked to jump into a classroom and say, what are you doing to integrate Common Core in your class? Well, this is Common Core. Students are evaluating, explaining, summarizing, identifying, choosing, things that we often identify with Common Core, and there's thousands of pages of research that kind of connect those two together and that make our Common Core. This is, we're calling this the Music Common Core in kind of some circles, and it really makes it a lot easier for us. So what does this have to do with my time at J.B. Young? Well, I decided as a music educator, I thought it'd be good for me to try and get myself my feet wet in these new national standards and try and design some curriculum and design some lesson plans that would work in this music classroom, which was a good opportunity for me. And so I was piloting it. I found that it was good for long-range curriculum planning, but for single lessons, that many standards is difficult to put together. So I taught the first lesson, and it was an absolute disaster. Oh, goodness. So what happened was I was focused a lot on those standards. I had to work backwards, and I was completely in survival mode. what was I going to do? I needed to teach this class 2 times a week, and I can't just go in there with my list of standards and say, well, we're going to learn today. So I decided to do a unit on found sounds. I'm like, I don't care about the standards anymore. I'm just going to go in and teach something that they're going to like. And there's a little cool video that I found that uses found sounds. It uses popular music. It's easy to connect to. It's maybe you've heard
before. With extraordinary powers, the X-Men will have to join.
Perhaps you've seen it before, but
yeah.
I think it's worth watching. It's fun. It's interesting. That's something far more engaging than my first lesson, which was about early 20th century Russian transcription music based on art paintings. Very rich in national standards, and something that I am deeply interested in, that I find fascinating, but I have a degree in music and you're second grade. So maybe not the best way to approach it.
A little less exciting for them, yeah.
Yeah, the idea was found sounds, making music out of things that are traditionally non-musical. Finding instruments from around the house or using musical instruments in non-traditional ways. They were hitting the piano in there, they were scraping the strings. Not how you typically play the piano. I brought in a box of stuff from my home, books and bags of coins and bits of metal and tin cans. They got to beat on as loud as they wanted, and I used activities that engaged them and had them lead class. I said, hey, Jeremy, can you play us a little 4-beat pattern for us all to echo? And we went around the room, and I gave them a lot of responsibility for the learning, and that got them engaged. Keep in mind, I did not look at the national standards once in this process. But I said, you know, that the entire reason I'm here is to look at these national standards in an urban setting. Did I have any success? I did. I hit, 7 national standards in that one lesson.
Mm.
It's pretty good, actually, considering the fact that I just put together a whole bunch of fun things for them to do and put it in a musical context. Suddenly I'm hitting 7 national standards all across the board. They're hitting a lot of the, all 4 of the major standard areas in this new set of national standards. So a pretty successful experience in that lesson. So what does that mean for me? I think that the national standards, it's really difficult for you to just design curriculum in the abstract. And in an urban school setting, I found myself referring frequently to the Kerwin book that we were using in Ed 451. And there's also another book by Eric Jensen who wrote,
Teaching with the Brain in Mind.
Teaching with the Brain in Mind. He also has a book called Teaching with Poverty in Mind.
Yeah.
And that was a big help for me. It's a lot about curriculum development and classroom environment development that helps you create a good environment for your students, keeping in mind the kinds of experiences they're bringing to your classroom with poverty being a significant part of their lives. So I found myself thinking about the students first and then developing curriculum in that regard. For a single lesson, that's pretty easy. You know, let's just do something fun and we'll hit a couple standards in the process just by accident entirely. But in terms of developing a curriculum, that's going to be a lot harder to do, coming up with lessons that do that, that had that many standards over the course of an entire year. So national standards in an urban setting, do they work? Are they designed for the nice, expensive districts that can afford this, they have the resources to do all sorts of these kinds of things, they have few discipline problems that don't have the issues of poverty in their classrooms. What are your thoughts on this? I don't know that I necessarily have an answer. I mean, this is doctoral thesis work over many careers, but in my experience, it's difficult to integrate, but I think that you need to at least try it. You have to figure out something to give your curriculum some credibility. Yeah.
Kind of like how you did was like looking back after you taught the lesson, I think is a good approach to it.
Mm-hmm.
And then maybe like compile a list of, you know, the standards that you're consistently hitting and maybe try and venture out after that to
mm-hmm.
see like, you know, I haven't really hit this one at all. Is there some
mm-hmm.
way I can try to incorporate that one?
Because
mm-hmm. I think, and it just maybe the way that you teach and I'm the same way, is I can't look at a standard and develop lesson that way. It's much more
mm-hmm.
natural for me to go the other route
yep.
to design
mm-hmm.
a lesson
and
try to fit a standard into it.
Exactly.
So maybe
theory is to follow practice.
Yeah, exactly. So
yep.
maybe afterwards trying to find a couple that you haven't worked on.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, you're going with the sort of the instinct, start where the students are,
mm-hmm.
what are their, you know, evaluate their needs, try to match an experience to their backgrounds, experiences, etc. Was the way to go. And chances are, if the standards are worth anything, you're going to end up hitting several of them, which you did.
Yeah, I think the nice thing about both sets of national standards, the old and the new, was most music teachers never had to change anything they were doing in either adaptation. If you were a good music teacher, you're doing all these things anyways. You just maybe have to, especially with Common Core coming around, you have to kind of tweak what you do just so the students know the academic vocabulary. They're like, oh, I'm identifying here. Oh, I'm explaining. I'm summarizing. I'm using data. I'm following, using evidence, that kind of thing. But good music teaching will happen naturally if you know what you're doing. You just don't need, you just suddenly have something that explains what you're doing.
What do you think of the standards, the new standards?
The new standards, I really do like them. I think they're very holistic, and there's an 1,100-page report that details why they're
yeah.
good. It looks at international standards. It looks at state standards that exist. It looks at Common Core, and that was the big document that was really good. It says, look, this standard, and this standard, and this standard, and oh, I didn't realize that, these standards all correlate to this English standard, so you're covering it in your classroom, which I think is going to be a huge benefit to music teachers who can just say, well, if you want me to integrate Common Core in my curriculum, surprise, it's already there, read this document, and I can prove it to you, and most administrators will say, I'll just take your word for it, so, because who wants to read that 1,100-page document? I think it's going to be a great help for teachers. I don't think a lot of them are going to sit down and read the whole thing. It's long, it's lengthy, it's hefty, but it's going to be a huge benefit to those who need a curriculum development guide. Any other questions, thoughts?
It'd be helpful, too, for, like, if a school's thinking about cutting the music or arts,
mm-hmm.
to
yeah.
have that as a defense
Absolutely.
For them
yeah.
to say that you're teaching force in those
Yeah,
kids.
We are already working within Common Core, which some
yeah.
teachers don't necessarily want to say, oh, I'm here to teach other subjects, but at the same time, it definitely justifies our existence.
Mm-hmm.
Makes it a little harder to say you're not doing anything worthwhile. Like, well, actually, Common Core is all over the place in my curriculum.
Kind of sad in a way, because the old standards granted you such flexibility and license to do different things,
mm-hmm.
you know?
Yeah. But at the same time, these still actually have quite a bit of flexibility. These are a lot of like dispositions that your students need to have
mm-hmm.
and kinds of skills that at a higher level they're doing. But they can still be doing any number of activities to reach those levels. So you still have that kind of flexibility and freedom in what you do.
Okay.
Any other thoughts, comments, questions, wise remarks? All right, well, thank you for coming.
Alicia and Abby, are you familiar with the new standards at all?
I actually, Dr. Zemek sent us a video a while ago from whoever those people are. It's a big name. I've watched it recently, like before, like going into interview. I'm like, you know, just in case they ask me about it, like
Good
at
thinking.
Least I'm aware
yeah.
of what's going to be happening with like the new standards. But like Mitchell said, it doesn't come out until June, so
yeah.
we haven't really had a chance to see it. The video was, you know, prefacing, like, this is what we're doing, like, this is what's, you know, the goal in mind for creating these standards, but yeah, I mean, I haven't gotten to take a look at them yet, but
I just got access to a draft, so I don't even know if these are going to be the final. I mean,
yeah.
The last thing will just be tweaking little bits of language, but it's definitely not the final product.
Yeah.
Interesting. Thanks, Mitch.
Thank you.
Fantastic. Caitlin.
Thanks, everybody, for coming.
Yeah. Good job, Mitch. See you guys.
Later. Did I